alongside my car. I got pictures, got candy, I'm a lovable man. I'd like to take you to the nearest star.
Hello, Shamrock Nation. Dave Sell here from class of 1979 from the Shamrock Jazz Orchestra. You probably have heard by now about our upcoming concert in July at the Magic Bag on Saturday, July 24th at 6 p.m. That's going to be quite the party. The Shamrock Jazz Orchestra is really throwing that party and are hosting it. But the party really is for you, East Detroit High School alumni, your family, your friends, your kids, your grandkids, and your parents too. Bring everybody you can. It's going to be a fantastic time. Consider it an all-year reunion with some great music, all coming from the East Detroit High School Jazz Band program. And that's what this group is. The orchestra is a mix of musicians over the course of 10 or 15 years even, of players that all participated in the Jazz Band program. And we've all gone on to different levels and capabilities of our musical playing chops, if you will. And I'm happy to have and be part of such an incredible group. We're having a blast. We're in prep mode right now. We're in full rehearsals. I would encourage you greatly to get your tickets. Just go to our website on the screen, shamrockjazzorchestra.com. There you can buy tickets and learn all about the concert. And do that as soon as you can, because they are selling very well. Okay, so with me today is one of the senior players, I would say that, in the jazz orchestra, and a member of a very, very famous musical family in the East Detroit School District or East Detroit area. Davey Lazar is with me today. Good morning, Davey.
Good morning.
How you doing?
I'm doing great. Doing great.
Good.
Not as great as out there in California, but enjoying the change of weather going on.
It's all perspective. If you like weather, we got it good out here. If you like high taxes, we don't have it good out here at all.
Right.
But let's talk a little bit about you and talk about your family and talk about the orchestra and so forth. So first of all, for our viewers, I'm going to let you know Davey is first chair trombone and one of our featured soloists that will let it rip and show off during our concert coming up on the 24th of July. But Davey, tell me about your family and tell me where you grew up and what schools you went to, because I think people would like to know that.
All righty. Our family, lived on Lincoln in East Detroit. All of us went to, Crescentwood Elementary School, then and really into the music programs. We all went through Oakwood Junior High School. And then, of course, East Detroit. We had a lot of us in the wind instrument activities. Well, there were 10 of us kids. There's 9 of us now. But all 10 of us played piano, and 8 of us played wind instruments. So I guess counting Oakwood and counting even Crescentwood, there was like... Yeah. I would say, you know, for each school, there was, for Oakwood and for the high school, there were 17 years in a row where there would be a Lazar, at least one, sometimes two, in the wind instrument programs. And the other two kids were into choir. So, you know, whatever, they couldn't. Oh. I mean,
that's a legacy. That is something to be proud of. And I graduated with your sister, Bev, and I knew your other younger brothers, I think Jim or Danny, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep,
that's right. I know all your names because there's a lot of you. But the fact is that it was such a well-known fact that the Lazar family was an incredible music family. So you must have had Mike Skrinsky as your Oakwood Junior High?
Yeah, we had Mike Skrinsky. All of us went through Mike Skrinsky. I can't remember when El Marco, and in the high school, when El Marco retired. I think the last couple of Lazars, Tina and Amy, I don't think they had El Marco.
Okay.
But, we outlasted him.
Yeah, right. He was incredible. We'll talk about him.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was.
Tell me about growing up there on... are in East Detroit, and yep. Was music in your home, and what did you folks, what did you guys do as a family musically?
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, there was never a quiet moment in our I always would practice in the basement. You know, my brother Johnny, he went to school with Mike Rohr, who's in the band. He practiced upstairs in the bedroom. Us brass players, we knew to kind of move out of the center of the house. But how many sisters played flute? Three. One, two, four. Wow. Four sisters played flute. And they always practice in the kitchen. Now, and I think a lot of people know that usually the kitchen is kind of a like singing in the shower type thing. There's a lot of echo.
Yeah.
Oh, and I love them all. But the flutes and piccolos in the kitchen were quite a thing to behold. Never a quiet moment when they were going.
Yeah. Only imagine after school, it must have sounded like a train wreck in that house, just simply because if more than two people were practicing.
Yeah, well, a lot of times it's kind of strange. Well, we were so spread out. There weren't that many people. Like when I was going through the high school, my sister, my older sisters and brothers were all out of the house. So I think it was spread out to where there was like always a piano going in the basement, flute going in the kitchen kind of thing. There was always at least a couple of things going on, it seemed like, but it was all good. I think it just kind of soaked into us because we had it all around us.
You know? Yeah. Your parents encouraged this and they were involved.
Pardon me?
My parents?
They were not. My dad, when he was young, played violin and he liked to sing, but they were never musical examples for us because they didn't play when we were kids. It actually began with really in terms of the wind. Oh, that's interesting. I honestly don't know who got it started on piano. My older brother probably played first, but my sister Susie, who went actually was in the jazz band, she played flute, but she played double bass for the jazz band. She actually taught us all piano. Wow. And
that's great.
I think she got it started, to be honest with you. She got it started and then we all followed suit. You know, she became a teacher and had flute choirs and everything. Now she's still playing, I'm sure, but she doesn't do a lot of the teaching in the flute choirs now, it seems like. But yeah, I think she was our first example to get us going.
That's an incredible run, if you'd want to use maybe that. Yeah. Sports analogy there, just 17 consecutive years of Lazar family members just working their way through the music program. And how fortunate we were to have such a well-run and well-funded and diverse choice of musical options as students, you know, interviewing Greg Maluski, you know, Boots, as we call them, last week. And we were talking about all the different bands there were. There was varsity band, pep band, concert band, jazz band, symphony band. And then that's just instruments. That's just bands. Then there were
marching choirs.
Marching band, yeah. Yeah, I don't know. Did anybody ever really consider marching band a real band, or was it just a party? I think it was a party, right?
Yeah, so...
Oh, that's great. Tell me about your family and whatever other musical endeavors you've taken on since getting out of the working role.
After I got my second degree, I also got married the very same year to Linda. And we've got three kids, Lindy, Samantha, and Davey. He's not a junior. My brother's middle name. It's his middle name.
All right.
Jimmy. And so they're all really great kids out on their own now. So we're empty nesters, enjoying that and enjoying retirement. In terms of musically through the years, I actually stopped playing, I would say, like in 1982, I stopped playing. I was graduating from Michigan State University. Then I was going back to school and was more about finding getting a degree that gets me a job and getting a job. So I stopped playing actually for about 10 years. And then just before Our third child was born. An old friend of mine just called me, hey, we need somebody in this band. And so I said, oh, you know, I haven't played for so long, I don't know if I can. But I went, and that was in 1991. And so that actually started up. I was just beginning to take up golf. I got myself a whole set of golf clubs, and I used them once because I got in the band. Right. And so I was, now I've been like always in at least two bands throughout the year. Sometimes I was in like five or six different bands. So it's been pretty active, doing all kinds of stuff, R&B, salsa bands, big bands, of course, big bands, small bands, all doing swing or all kinds of styles. So
right.
You know, I've been pretty active since 91, actually, you know.
Yeah, I hear that you've been, you're in the band Intrigue right now, which is a kind of a corporate wedding.
That was like a wait a lifetime to get in a band like that. It's an awesome opportunity. Yeah, it's great.
I did look it up and saw the videos, and it's impressive. It's a big group too.
It is. It's a big group, and so much great. I mean, there's three of us horns, but the vocals, sometimes they'll have five or six people going at the same time singing harmonies and all these kind of doo-wops. And it's not always doo-wops. Mostly it's like top 40s type music. They're so good. And it's a great band to be a part of. Yeah.
It's exciting to play with such a talented group of players. And that's the way I feel certainly about the group that we've put together, because, you know, being in the room with all of you guys, and everybody is an established excellent player in their own right, putting it all together is where the magic really happens.
Yeah. And these are the kind of bands where you're in it, and you enjoy, it's, to me, it's an entertainment just to watch,
right.
You know, the old folks, the fellow musicians from the high school, or, you know, the Intrigue, or, you know, when it's a super band like that, it's such an enjoyment to watch them. It's my entertainment. But then also, and we'll get to that point when we're actually performing, is when there's so much crowd that enjoys it. That's really why we do it.
Of course.
See so many actual people in a crowd enjoying it so much. Yeah. It's rewarding.
So, Davey, listen, in addition to that great experience and the fun that you have with Intrigue, I also understand you were fortunate enough to play with Alto Reed from the Silver Bullet Band.
That's correct. He started a travel group he called Alto Reed and the All-Stars, which were... primarily Dave Mason, who sang We Just Disagree and something
right.
Like that.
Great. Big hit. Big hit. Yeah.
Yeah. Mark Farner from Grand Funk Railroad and Mitch Wright, Detroit, wow. Famous Detroit.
Right.
So those three guys in Alto would every couple of months or every few months would do a travel gig somewhere. And he used a group of small group of us musicians, just four horns, vocalist, keyboard, small group like that. And so I was fortunate enough to be a member of that group. We traveled off and on for 3 years, a lot of stuff in California, throughout the United States, Florida, different places, Puerto Rico. It was a great experience, just to be able to watch these national talents and how meticulous, but how nice they were. But how meticulous they were in preparing and doing a presentation and to do their music. But just how meticulous they were was a good experience to watch.
Wow.
I'll never be that meticulous, but I understand the value of it. That's for sure.
Yeah,
that was a great experience. A lot of fun.
All right, Dave. So now let's go back a little bit to our high school days, your high school days and jazz band specifically. What years were you in the jazz band?
I was in the jazz band from 1974 through 1977.
Right. And what members of the Shamrock Jazz Orchestra that we've put together now did you play with in jazz band in high school?
Tom Dembeck.
Trumpet.
Bob McGetty.
Trumpet.
And I tend to think Randy Jordan, but it wasn't Randy Jordan. I went to He went to school with my younger brother, but he was close with our whole family. Spent a lot of time with him. So I kind of, when I was at the last rehearsal, I was thinking I went to school with Randy, but then I thought about it just the other day. I didn't. I just saw him so much as a you know, youngster playing ball, going camping, all the stuff we did together. I kind of felt like I went to school with him. Anyways, those two trumpet players, I think, were the only ones in this band that that I was in the jazz band with.
Well, there's
Ray Oset actually went through the jazz band with my older sister and brother just before I got there.
Right.
So yeah, I know Ray from way back then too.
You also participated in jazz band with some other incredible players that unfortunately couldn't commit to our effort here, but guys like Dominic Lombardi and Paul Ventimiglia and so forth. Tell us about being in the band with those guys, because they clearly were musical leaders.
Oh yeah, yeah. They were great. I joined I started in the jazz band in 10th grade. Part of my most favorite things about that was just watching those guys. Sat right behind the sax section, of course, and my brother Jimmy and Dominic Lombardi. I think they were like the key soloists of the band. I mean, in terms of the wind instruments, and they would have some duels that were just so great. And just sitting directly behind them, watching them go at it, they both had their own unique things they could do.
Yeah.
Band screaming different stuff, doing, you know, things to them. It was just a lot of fun. El Marco off to the side, as he always was, kind of with his arms folded and his head tilted and that smile on his face, you know, just watching everybody.
Proud.
It was all really good. Yeah, and then the other guys, Paul Ventimiglia, Tom Dembeck, Rick Flores, I believe it was guitar. I just was thinking about that the other day. But those guys were fantastic. Tom Dembeck was just like the ultimate screech trumpet player through. I think he was there 2 years while I was there.
Okay.
He graduated before.
For musicians, we know what you mean when you say when they're going at it and so forth. Like, for example, between Dominic and somebody else, tell the group, the audience here, really, what does that mean? You're sitting behind the saxophone section, so you've got the trombone and you're extending your slide. And I'm sure you gave him a few love taps on the back of the head. But, you know, what does it mean in non-musical terms when you say those kind of things so people know?
Yeah, yeah. When I say going at it, they were improvising. A lot of times people don't even, the general crowd doesn't know a musician's improvising when they hear them doing that. They actually are a certain section of the song. They've got an open section where a musician like Dominic or Jimmy would just stand up and make something up and try and be as cool and funky or swinging as they can be. Made up music, improv.
And, on the spot.
When the two of them are going at it, is like they're battling back and forth. One plays an idea, the other answers with another idea, and they're trying to outdo each other. You know, and that's when the whole band would be getting at it and screaming at the two musicians. I remember they used to scream, "Growl, Jimmy, growl," because he had he could do that thing sax players can do where they actually growl in their voice while they're playing, and it causes this raspy sound. And he was really into that in high school.
So that was a lot of fun. In a different way. I mean, it's a duel, right? So, you know.
It was a duel. Yeah, musical duel. But everybody walked away from it.
Right. Yeah, no one got hurt. But it is like that. It's competitive in that respect. And I remember a young guy in jazz band when I was there, which was 78 and 79, Greg Maluski came in as a skinny young kid and got thrown right into the fire. And I remember watching it. I clearly remember watching him play improvise and doing incredibly well. And it stuck with me forever. And I told him that when we got reconnected, I said, "Man, you know that, I've never forgotten that, you know, way back all those years ago." So, it takes guts and there's nothing like being put on the spot and just you get pointed at. It's like, no, you have 4 bars, make something happen. And we're going to do that in our show as well. So for the audience here, part of the fun for us as musicians is what we're discussing. So at different moments and different numbers in the concert, we're going to be trading off, and some of it might, it's all going to be live and on the spot and unplanned and spontaneous. And that's part of the fun for us. And when you get musicians at this level who can really make that happen, that's when electricity happens and you get goosebumps on your arms and all that stuff. So sure. Yeah. I'm looking forward to that and many more things. So, all right, Davey, you've had an incredible musical life. Your family and your siblings is just an incredible run. I'll say it again, 17 years with in the Lazar family, being in the musical program at East Detroit. If Al Markel were with us today and I were to ask him, what family do you recognize and would you consider to be your number one choice? I'm sure he would say the Lazar, not only from quantity, but from quality and value too.
I was going to say, if you start saying the same thing over and over again, or seeing the same people for 17 years, somehow they make an impression whether you like it or not.
well, to your credit and to your family's credit, is nothing but an incredibly positive impression for all of us, not just on Al Markel. So thanks for joining me today, Davey. I appreciate your time. We'll see you in a couple weeks for our next live rehearsal. Shamrock Nation, make sure that you go to the website you see on your screen, shamrockjazzorchestra.com. Ticket sales are moving very, very quickly, and it's going to be a great night. Don't forget to forward our posts and visit our website. Tell your friends, your family, your kids, your grandkids, your parents, and we hope to see you there Sunday, July 24th, Magic Bag, 6 p.m. Gotta get back here.